What's the big difference between one and another?
And that whole thing is finally about the brand value or the perception that is in the mind of the customer. Okay? So I think what you need to keep in mind is as you form yourselves into companies or startups or organizations, unless you're clear about your vision, your goal, and where you want to go from there, and then translate that into an explanation out into the public. Okay, you're not going to be able to build a good brand. Okay, because ultimately that brand is what people will finally pay the price for. Ultimately it translates down to money. So one is, if you have a product or service that you're offering, people will pay something for it. And finally, when you build it to a certain volume, you might want to actually get acquired or sell it or create a valuation for it. Okay? And if you really look at the balance sheets of companies today, the actual tangible assets, okay, which could include, you know, the physical property and the furniture and the whatever, is probably about 20 to 30% of the total value of the company. The other part of the company is all brand value. It is all perception. So people pay a higher valuation because they believe that there are certain fundamentals of the business that are running. And based on those fundamentals, they are willing to put money down because they believe that they can acquire that inherent stuff. So there is nothing to give them. It's all intangible assets that are basically getting created. And that gets created because of the good branding that is done. So I used to be in iFlex. I spent about 10 years as head of marketing and communications. And we used to have this very interesting chart that got into our investor presentations. You know, so it said, at inception, you know, we were here and now we are here. So we looked at it across various parameters. One was, of course, customers. The other was countries that we service. And then there was one which talked about the actual investment that Citibank made into the company. They bought a 42% stake when they started. And they put a few million dollars into the company. And ultimately, when we sold it to, Oracle bought the stake. They bought it for $2 billion. Okay? So we showed that kind of a progression. Or little before the actual sale of that, it was in the market, so there was market capitalization, and we showed the market capitalization of the company and said that this is the value of the stock that's out in the market. Okay, trades at whatever, 2,500 bucks a share. Okay, so that was the value. Now, if you ask me, if you were to break up all that and say, so does it mean that you have 2 billion worth of tangible assets? The answer is certainly not. Okay, but it's basically the intellectual property, it's all the branding, the perception that got created over a period of time. That basically led to this. Okay. So, any questions so far? Anything you want to ask, or you want to disagree with me, or anything you want to say?
Okay. Well, selling our goods for a lower price decrease our brand value.
It all depends. It may not. It all depends
like
on
the R1, the motor of Monsanto, not the motor of the. Yeah. For example, the car.
See, it's not about the price you sell it. It's about the perception that the customer has about your product. That's basically what it is all about. It is ultimately about that. So, you might be making a loss. For example, today, a company like Flipkart, okay, is not exactly making profits quarter on quarter. Okay? But to a customer like me, if I sit on the customer side, I get immense value shopping on Flipkart. The perception is great. And the other day, they sent a mailer saying that we've launched shoes for gents on Flipkart. I bought 2 pairs that evening. I was so happy because when I bought it, I went and ordered it on a Saturday evening at 10 o'clock in the night. On Monday, it was in my office. I didn't have to go outside. And coincidentally, my wife is very upset because they don't sell lady shoes, they only sell gent shoes. But when we went to the store and she wanted to buy something, the shoes that I bought in the store were 400 rupees more. So I was even more overjoyed. Okay? Now, whether they are selling it at a loss, whether they are incurring costs to make that delivery possible, to me, it doesn't matter, unless I'm an investor. To me, there's a certain satisfaction that I derive from the brand, because I asked for something, I got it. I got it maybe 10% or 15% cheaper than what I would have had to do if I had to go out to the store. So I think that's the way to look at it. It depends who you are. So you have to, if you're invested in Flipkart, maybe you're not going to be very happy. But if you're a consumer of Flipkart, why not? That's basically what it is. The other thing that you've got to remember in this whole branding exercise is, and which I think is the primary audience, is basically, the primary thing is who's the audience? Okay? And you know, he mentioned, it's about the person you're writing to and what that person is going to get out of the whole thing. Okay? So the question is, if I am today coming and telling you that, you know, you must buy this watch, the first thing that's going to cross your mind is, so what's in it for me? What am I going to derive the benefit of buying this watch? What is the satisfaction I'm going to get out of this whole thing? If there is something that I'm going to get that is going to make me better, my value is going to go up in the market, there is something more that I'm going to get out of it, then perhaps there is something that I will see value in buying. Okay? And I will actually make that investment to get it out. But if I'm not going to get anything out of it, then why should I even bother about it? The problem that many of us make in our pitches when we are actually going out to the target audience is, we do not study the target audience enough. We do not put ourselves in the shoes of the target audience and ask what the target audience will expect of us. Okay? So when we go out, we are so enthused with our product, or we are so enthused with what we have to offer. The first thing we want to tell everybody is that, you know, I do this, I make this, this is a great thing, etc., etc. And that guy all the while is thinking to himself, so what's in it for me? What's the benefit I'm going to get out of this? Okay? And in jargon, that's called a value proposition. So people keep talking about value proposition. Okay? Value proposition is nothing but what is in it for me. And that comprises two or three things. One is, it comprises some kind of a benefit statement that the customer is going to derive from that. Okay? The second thing that a value proposition comprises is an actual value, okay, in terms of some benefit that you're going to get, in the sense that you will save 70% if you buy this. You will save $1 million if you buy this. That is a value proposition. Okay? It's a tangible saving or a tangible benefit. So it's not only a qualitative benefit, where I tell you, your life will become better. Oh, what's going to happen if my life is going to become better? No, the products that sell the best are where the value proposition has some number attached to it, or some saving attached to it. And the third part of it is that there is some demonstration of a benefit being actually enjoyed by somebody else. So they use it and they get the benefit of it. Okay? So, as an example, if you look at a company like Oracle, they do very simple advertising. There's no big funder creative that they do. But they just say 20 of the top 20 banks in the world use Oracle. So they make a very simple statement. 20 of the top 20 banks. So what they're trying to get out at you as a customer is, if 20 of the top 20 banks are using Oracle, then I mean why should I have any doubt about using Oracle products? I should have a problem. It should be a great product that I should use. And that's the only kind of advertising that we do. So we talk about 20 of the top 20 banks and 20 of the top 20 groceries and 20 of the top 20 pharmaceutical companies and so on and so forth. A lot of companies today talk in those terms, saying that I have 75 of the top 100 Fortune 100 companies or whatever as customers. Why do they tell you that? They're not trying to brag, they're only trying to tell you that if those guys can use my product or service and they're happy with it, then you should also be happy with it. You should also enjoy a benefit or something like that. So I think the thing that you've got to remember is, you've got to project that value prop to the customer. Very often, the first level of interface with the customer is a company's website. Okay? And that, on the top, you know, there's some nice big space over there where you have to say something. That space is unfortunately often used to talk about your product, your service, without even telling the customer why he should engage with you, or what's the value that you get out of this whole thing. Okay? So what you want to remember is, when you're actually building your website, spare a thought for what is the value that your target audience is going to get out of this. Which also means, inherently, that you should know who your target audience is. So who is the guy who's purchasing the product? And as you know well, in every company, there are different levels of people who buy products, okay, or buy a service, or buy an offering from you. So there could be the management level, okay, which is, what do you think management is looking for whenever they are trying to buy something? Some of you may be the CEOs of your organization, what do you think you're looking for? If somebody comes to sell you something, what do you look for?
more value will I get?
Yeah, so what value will I get? What can I save? Okay, what's the return? If you're asking me to pay $100,000, what will I get out of it? What's the return I get?
So basically, first of all, needed for our company.
Is it needed at all? Does it fit into what I need? So that's basically it. So he is looking more at a business benefit. For a company, what is the business benefit I need to look for? If you were the CTO of the company who's running the technology, what would you look for? What's the question you would ask? Is it the latest?
Does it match with the existing technology?
Will it fit in? Will it integrate with all my existing technology that is there?
Which is the cheapest technology?
Will it do something to improve maybe the workflow that I have currently?
Cost. Cheapest technology?
Yeah, cost. In a CTO's mind, yeah, he does control the budget, so he will look at that little down the stream. But his main thing is really to ask the question, if I'm going to bring this animal into my company, will it fit with all the other things that I'm doing? Or do I have to throw out everything else and replace it? Then I have a problem with that. Because, or is this technology that you're bringing to me so proprietary that I can't run it independently? I have to keep depending on you to do something. Those are typical CTO kind of questions that you get. And then there's the CFO. Okay? And the CFO is only looking at one thing. He's looking at the green bags. Yeah, he's looking at the money. Why do we have to spend so much? Can we get it 50% cheaper? Can we get it from the alternative vendor? Can we see three codes? Okay, of a similar pattern of product. Now the point is that when you are sending out that value proposition on a website, which any one of these people could be accessing, you must be able to answer the questions of all of them. So your business benefit, your cost benefit, and that technology proposition must be very, very clearly amplified upfront in that communication that you're doing. Okay? And believe me, today, the first port of call for many people is the company's website. So if your website is not in that shape that answers these questions, okay, then you have a problem. Because they're not going to get hooked into taking the step forward. Many people, for example, are looking at, they need a solution. It's not like you go to them, they need a solution. They might actually do a search in Google and maybe your company comes up because your rankings are good and they click on it. But if they don't get an answer, they need an answer in about a minute's time. It's like that elevator pitch. They have about a minute. If they don't get that answer in a minute, that's the end. They go to a competitor and they buy from the competitor. So you have to remember that essentially you have to provide that quick value prop upfront in your website and in your collateral right up there, which can answer the business question, the finance question, the technology question. It should answer all those questions comprehensively. Okay, very, very, very neatly. And then once it does that, obviously the decision maker is not happy only with that. He wants more information. Then you pan it out into other documents and so on and so forth. So if you really look at it in your entire kit or in your entire armory that you need to have while going about this brand building exercise, you have to have sufficient amount of content that will basically engage these audiences. Okay? Now when I say content, what do I mean? One is enough of meat on the website. The other is you need to have enough of data sheets, for example, which talk more in depth about the product or the service that you're offering to the desired target segment. So if you're talking to the telecom sector, you need to have something for them. If you're talking to the healthcare sector, you need to have something for them. They are interested also in getting a comfort factor that you know that sector. Okay, you understand that sector. You're able to meet the requirement of that sector. So you're not just a guy who provides the technology. So I want, you know, some system. How does that system fit into an overall process workflow in a hospital or in a bank? Okay, or in an airline company, or wherever else you are deploying a solution, or in a telecom company. They need to understand how that whole thing goes. And that needs to come from your understanding of the domain. So your domain understanding becomes critical when you're actually building that kind of brand presence with your customer. And that comes out a lot in the collateral that you put. The other thing that customers are looking for in this whole branding exercise, they are looking for, so you have implemented it for somebody? I want to know about that. comes out in the form of what is called a case study, okay, which is a very, very kind of a popular thing. Now, many of my clients come to me and say, very good, you are good at preaching all this nice thing, you tell me case study and all that, my customer doesn't want to open his mouth. He doesn't want to endorse. He says, what's in it for me? I don't want to come and, why should I come and endorse you? What do I have to kind of gain out of it? That sometimes is a problem. Okay, so customers are not willing to kind of give an open endorsement and say, I use this product, I'm very happy with it. Okay, there are ways of countering it. So one way of countering it is write anonymous case studies. Okay, where you don't name the customer, but you just say that a large pharmaceutical company or a bank which operates in 100 countries, you know, talk in generic terms and get something written up. But it is very important for you to get a case study written up, because unless you have a good case study, other people who are operating in your segment will not believe that you have the competency or capability of doing something. So that becomes very critical in your whole armory that you want to send out outside. I would imagine that for the initial part of your branding exercise, the initial part of what you are trying to get out to the audience, these are three or four very important things. So a good data sheet or a brochure or whatever you want to call it, a good website, and a good a couple of case studies that you want to reach out. I think that makes a good kind of a starting point for your entire brand building exercise. Couple of things in this whole thing is, one is get your keywords straightened out. Okay, so what are the keywords that emerge out of the service or offering that you provide? Okay, those keywords play an important role in getting your rankings up when you do your search engine optimization as well. So what are those key things, those key phrases that you want to include? They should be repeated over these various collaterals that you put out, particularly your web collateral. The other key thing is, on the website, you need to have content that is always fresh. Okay. So there are a lot of people who, you know, build the Taj Mahal and then they just leave it. They don't go back there again and do anything to it. That doesn't help. In today's dynamic world, you want to have a mechanism of putting content up on a frequent and regular basis. In fact, I would encourage you to look at some of the trends that people are talking about in content marketing. Okay, and there's an institute in the US called the Content Marketing Institute, it's called the CMI. Okay, which regularly polls companies to find out what are the kind of things that people are looking for in the brand building process. So you can go to the CMI website, take a look at some of the trends that are occurring. What are the kind of rankings of material, okay, that are going out to various people? I think that's something that you need to understand. Coming back to the audience, what you also need to understand today is that, particularly with the younger set of audience, okay, who are all here, attention spans are very short. Okay, so like this whole thing of what I'm trying to do here, give a big speech, is actually probably not going very well with many people here. Okay, because it's starting to get a little boring. It needs to be shorter. It needs to be more crisp. It needs to be material that is more audiovisual appealing. Okay. So a big trend that I'm seeing today in the market, particularly with my customers who are in the tech sector, they're all moving to infographics, they're all moving to video. Okay, those are big trends that we're seeing today. And therefore, so if I ask them, what are your priorities for 2013? The priorities for 2013 are, I want to make more videos. Nobody is saying, I want to write more blogs, or I want to write more brochures, or anything. I want to make more videos. That's what people are saying. Because they believe getting 2 minute videos, putting them up on a YouTube, okay, captures attention better. Okay, so that's something. So I don't know whether you agree or disagree. I don't know what your view is, but that's what I'm hearing from a lot of the customer segments.
Even that saves a lot of our energy also, like even giving demos and all, it takes a lot of manpower.
Precisely.
We just did suddenly.
Yeah, that's what it is. And it creates the first impression. The other thing you've got to remember is that video, the way videos are produced is very different from how they were done earlier. So earlier, producing a video was like, you know, producing one Bollywood film. Okay, you had lights and cameras and all kinds of things. Today, the technology is, you know, you can just take an iPhone and shoot a video. You can put a few slides together, you can mix them up on your desktop, and you can publish. Okay, so perceptions have to change. The problem with many companies is that there are people like me who are above 40 and there are people who are below 40, and there's always a conflict between the above 40s and the below 40s. Okay? So I was talking to a client day before yesterday, and they were experimenting a new format where the CTO of the company, it's MNC, the CTO was coming from overseas, and they wanted to broadcast a message to the entire audience. So somebody who was in the below 40 category said, let's do a webcast. So the above 40 were very upset. No, how can we do a webcast? We should get everybody into one room. How can we do this kind of thing for a webcast? Ultimately, they did a webcast. They found that the satisfaction level was much higher. People today in the younger generation, as you well know, are easier at multitasking. So I can have a webcast running, I can be watching something else, I can be doodling, I can be googling, I can be doing all that, but I'm still getting a message. I think that's the kind of thing that you've got to look at. So the trend is changing. It's not a trend where everything is kind of, you know, brought into a classroom kind of a mode, but it's more an informal way of kind of communicating with brand outside. So, if I look at the overall picture, then I think what I'd like to say, you know, when it comes to branding and when it comes to, the first thing about it is not as laborious an exercise as some people perceive. So it is not something that, you know, you want to kind of put together with an army of people. It's a simple thing that you can do, and if you use a good amount of intelligence and some smart ways of doing things, you can actually create that perception in the market yourself. Okay, you don't need to have an army of consultants who kind of have to come and help you with that. You can actually do it yourself. You can start very simply by, for example, monitoring the pulse outside. Okay, another big trend that's going around today is that people are saying, you know, in my days, if you wanted to do a marketing campaign, you actually ran this campaign, okay, so you put together elements of the campaign, collateral, email, everything. Today people are saying campaign is an outdated way of thinking. Marketing is on 24/7. So what is marketing? Marketing is not about campaigns. Marketing is about reacting to forces in the market. So what people are commenting on, okay, in a social media environment is what marketing is all about. So you don't have to plan something, but you only have to respond to something. Okay? That's the way you got to do that. Which also implies that you got to have people in the company who are listening, not only people who are talking. Okay? Again, it's an attitudinal change. Because 20 years back when I started my career in the tech industry, a lot of it was about talking. So everybody was spending time talking. We talked on our website and told people what we did. We talked at forums and told people what we did. We wrote proposals and wrote to people about our competency, we wrote capability documented. Today it's not about that, it's also about listening to what people want and responding appropriately. It's not just about preaching from our end. So that's one fundamental shift in the whole industry. The second fundamental shift is basically that people are not marketers any longer, but I would rather say people have become publishers. Okay, so you're not really marketing your message outside on a continuous basis, but you are somebody who runs a department which is more like a newspaper department. Okay, you are listening to what the sentiment is, you are picking out the top trend and you are pushing it out in a story every day virtually. Okay, you have become a publishing department, not a marketing department. A marketing department has its own life cycle to kind of take you through things. A publishing department is instantaneous. The third thing I think which is very important for you to remember is, it's no longer kind of only dependent on what a central team can do, but it's more kind of a crowdsourced solution. So your marketing department doesn't end, you know, with the junior marketing person and the senior marketing person and all that. It actually ends with all the employees in your company. So all of them are marketers, which means all of them have to be equally informed about the product, the service, whatever they're doing outside. So it's not about this finite group of people who are sitting in a room, but it's about people who are outside the room also who contribute. And that is, I think, sometimes a point that we miss, because we believe that we have the sacred reserve of doing everything. Very interesting, but a few, I think, months back, there was somebody who who was writing something on a blog and who actually used the logo of a multinational company on that blog. And within a few seconds, somebody said, hey, this is the wrong logo, this is not the logo to use, please use this logo. So this guy got pretty hurt and he said, who are you? And he said, I am the brand manager of the company. So he said, so what? If you are the brand manager, I don't care, this is a public forum. I can do what I like and I can say what I want, okay? The point I'm trying to make is today, things are changing, where the world out there is a world that is actually contributing. So it's become like a public well. You put water into it, you draw water out of the same well. And it's done by everybody. It's not like one guy has a job of doing it. That's the change that's happening. So you have to be mentally. So if you look at it from a negative point of view, my God, I don't know how many million people I have achieved with. But if you look at it from a positive point of view, I have a million people who can campaign for my company. It can be looked at both ways. You've got to get the latter part fixed, where you can get a lot of people talking positive things about your company. A lot of the brands that got built, okay, in India today, have got built also by a lot of people talking about the company very positively. It could be employees. And very often the point is missed. How many of the employees are happy with what happens? Okay, and are therefore willing to kind of reach out and talk. Okay. So I used to tell my branding guys and the agency guys, they should come up with some very nice recruitment ads, you know, in the old days, very, very savvy ads to catch the attention of people. And I'd say it's great, you spend, you know, 20 lakhs on a campaign, put it out in newspapers, put on hoardings, do all that. But when the alumni association meets on Friday for a beer, and one guy says, you know, I work for this crap company, they don't listen to me, the increments are bad, they don't bother, there's no suggestion mechanism, you know, they talk negatively. What's the point of spending 20 lakhs on the ad? There's no point. So outside you can create a nice aura and a great impression. But internally, if people talk badly about your company, those who work for you, you have a problem there. You've got to fix that. So, just to kind of sum up, first thing is get your value prop straight, okay, and get your mission, vision, where you're going, what you're heading, what your story is, get that aligned. Second thing, get your tools of communication in place, okay. So your fundamental stuff like your website, your collaterals, your case studies, you know, get all that done. Don't worry if you don't have too much of material for that, but use your own imagination to respond also on public forums to see how that goes. Listen to who the public is. Understand who your audience is and get that value proposition straight into the audience. I think if you're able to repeat this formula time and again to people, using content as the basis for reaching out, then I think, you know, you will get your branding and your image kind of built in the market consistently over a period of time. The last bit of advice is that branding is a laborious process. So it's not something that, like a switch, you know, turns on in the morning and off in the evening. It takes a long period of time. Unfortunately, the reverse is also not true. For example, your brand can get demolished in a few seconds. So you've got to be aware of that. You've got to, because there are enough people around who are listening, monitoring, and who can actually write things which are negative. So while you can build your brand, it may take, you know, several months or years to build your brand. It can take a few minutes to kind of demolish the brand or to kind of dent the brand. You've got to be cognizant of that and therefore keep listening out into the market, you know, more cautiously. I think that's something that's very important. Okay? So I'm happy to take any questions you may have from your own experiences or anything that you want to share, anything that you want to talk about.
So what is it like branding? Is a measure of for the social media? So how do you look at it? Like, you know, how can that impact?
It all depends on the kind of product or service that you're offering. And ultimately it's a factor of where your audience is. So ultimately that's it. So if your audience is on a particular social media channel, then you cater to that channel, you talk to that channel, you build your community in the channel. I work with a company today which is in the high-end engineering space. For them, their audience is basically, you know, VPs of engineering, that's their audience. We're using LinkedIn to actually build a community. So we're actually putting engineers